The title of today's message is, We Count Them Happy Which Endure. That comes from James chapter 5 and verse 11. And you see the picture here. Now that's enduring. You know, that doing that kind of thing, he's enduring in a way that I wouldn't even attempt. But that's a picture of endurance. That's why I wanted to keep that up there. But the James chapter 5, 11 says, Behold, we count them happy which endure. You have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. I want to ask you a question. When you see that word endure, what are the first three letters of that word? What does that say?
End.
To endure means to continue, and to continue, and to continue. It doesn't matter how hard it gets, how difficult, or how challenging it gets. You continue, and you continue until the end. That's what Job found out at the end of all of his trials. He found the Lord in his pity and his mercy. Well, the Lord is an everlasting Lord. His attributes and his holy character endures forever and ever. We're going to go over some verses. I won't have time to read them all, but if you have some pen and paper, you can jot down these scripture references. If you don't want to do that, you just steal your neighbor's notes. You can do that way, although you will have to repent. Well, let's look at these nine songs, these nine verses from Psalms that talk about these characteristics of God. These are enduring characteristics. These are characteristics that do not change. Our God is God who does not change. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. How long is forever?
Forever.
So he does not change. We call that the immutability of God. God not only does not change, he cannot change. He's perfect. If he were to change, he would no longer be perfect. Amen? So, let's look at these nine verses from the Psalms. It says, The glory of God endures forever. Psalm 104, verse 31. Psalm 104, verse 31. The glory of God endures forever. Psalm 100, verse 5 says, God's truth endures forever. Psalm 52, verse 1 says, God's goodness endures continuously. And Psalm 106, verse 1, God's mercy endures forever. Thank you, Lord. His mercies endure forever. His goodness and his mercy are also spoken of in Psalm 23, verse 6. It says, Surely, that is confidently, that is with absolute certainty, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Mm. Now that, those two words, follow me, goodness and mercy shall follow me. In the Hebrew, that is the word radaf, and it means to pursue, to chase down, to overcome with determined intent. That's God's goodness, his mercy for you. He's determined to bless you with his mercy and his goodness. Isn't that a blessing?
Yes.
Amen. If you ever considered that maybe you've so exasperated the heart of God because of this one particular area in your life that you're stumbling in, you haven't gotten the victory yet, and you're heartbroken, and you grieve, and you pray, Lord, please, I don't want to do this. Help me. And you continue. And you come across the moment of weakness, and you stumble, and you fall again. And you wonder, will God still show mercy upon me? Well, if you've ever wondered that, I have in my walk, I've wondered many times, Lord, how many times are you going to forgive me? How many times are you going to wash me? And his answer to me was, as many times as you fall, I'm going to pick you back up and wash you with my blood and the water of the word, and I'll strengthen you to continue. That's how many times I'm going to do that. He is good. He is merciful. Well, as I said, if you ever feel exasperated and grieved and wonder, will God still show mercy? Psalm 136 is your song. At the end of every verse in that song, it goes on for a couple dozen verses, it says, The mercy of God endures continuously. Well, what else of God, his character? What else endures? The scripture says in Psalm 30, verse 5, that the anger of God endures for a moment. Just for a moment. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that just a moment. Yeah, that's good. That's good. That's very reassuring. Psalm 111, verse 3 says, his righteousness endures forever. God's dominion endures everlastingly, it says in Psalm 105, verse 13. His loving kindness and faithfulness endures forever, Psalm 89, verse 33. And his name, it says in Psalm 72, verse 17. It says, his name endures forever. And his name is Jesus. Amen. Philippians 2, verse 9 through 11. Let's turn there. Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 through 11, it says, wherefore God has also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. What else can we learn of God's endurance? He endured the cross. He endured the cross. Hebrews 12, verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of the faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. Question. And near the beginning of that verse it says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. What was that joy that was set before him? He's there on the cross, excruciating agony. And yet there was a joy that was set before him that enabled him to endure. What was that joy? Amen. It was all of you. By his redemption, he realized that we would not be suffering eternally in the torments of hell. We would be delivered from the kingdom of darkness, delivered from the slavery of sin, and delivered into the holy kingdom of God, there to worship the Lord in love and joy and everlasting peace, in the presence of God, worshiping holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. What a joy that he would have eternal fellowship with you and you, all of us. That's what caused him to endure, not focusing on the excruciating agony that he was in, but on God's eternal objective, God's eternal mission. He was looking ahead, and that helped him to endure. And while we have glimpsed into the heart of God in these few verses, and all those glorious and awesome attributes and holy characteristics of the Lord God, and we're blessed to have it so. Now, concerning ourselves, let me ask you this. How many of you have known someone who called himself a brother, a sister in the Lord, who professed Jesus? Someone that you went to fellowship with? Someone that you prayed with? Someone that you just had relationship with in Christ, and they no longer today walk with the Lord? Can I see a show of hands? Easily half of us. Easily half of us. And it's heartbreaking. It is. I've known the Lord for about 36 years. And the one thing about being in the Lord that long, you meet a lot of people. And I can look down the corridor of time in my memory and know the people that are no longer walking with the Lord. And it is heartbreaking. And as much as it's heartbreaking for us, imagine God's heart breaking for these who at one time professed to know him, to love him, to follow him, and that are no longer following him. I know of a young man who a believer, and today he's attempting through mysticism to open his third eye that he may obtain spiritual knowledge. And this was someone that I walked with, someone that I prayed with, someone that I shared the word with. I know another young man, just by reputation, a brother of ours brought him to our attention to pray for him. And he actually had what he called an anti-baptismal ceremony, where he denounced Christ. And he took a picture of his journal that he wrote to Jesus, this little diary entries, he writes things in prayer to Jesus. And he took a picture of this in the fireplace burning. And he shared that with all his Christian friends. These did not endure. In Luke chapter 18 and verse 8, Jesus says, I tell you, he will avenge them speedily, speaking of himself. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on the earth? Will the Lord find faith upon his return? Will he find those who have endured all things and come to the end, holding fast to the word of truth, as it says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13? In these last days, iniquity is abounding, as Jesus mentioned in Matthew 24. And the falling away from the faith is happening in an increasing degree. And speeding up, increasing in its intensity and its frequency. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 speaks of that. Churches are forsaking the fountains of living waters. And they're resorting to broken cisterns that hold no water, as it says in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 13. The Lord is looking for faithfulness in his children so that he may declare on that day, well done, good and faithful servant. How he yearns to say that over us. As much as we yearn to hear that from him, he desires to say that over us. Well done, good and faithful servant. He's looking for that kind of endurance and that patience that won't give up on the truth of his promises. Amid the hardships and the persecutions and the trials, like it says in James 5:11, we count them happy which endure. That word happy is the same word used in the Beatitudes when Jesus says, blessed are you, and blessed are you, and blessed are you. He, all the Beatitudes, he lists those. It's the same word there. It means a quiet gladness, a joyful peacefulness. A blessedness. Happy are those that endure. Well, what is needed now more than ever is spiritual endurance. Half of us easily think of someone who once walked with the Lord and no longer does. We need this spiritual endurance. If ever there's a time to persevere with a sense of urgency, if there's ever a time amidst all the struggles and hardships of life and the persecution that is increasing in this world and I believe soon to come to this country, if ever there is a time when we need to abide in him and have his words abide in us, that time is now. That time is now. We need to, with determination, born of the Holy Spirit, say and declare before this world and before the enemy, most of all before the Lord, that we will not give up, we will not walk away, we will not forsake the Lord or his ways. Now is that time that we shine in the midst of this perverse and crooked nation, as it says in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 15. We're going to read that in a moment. In John chapter 6, Jesus was saying some very hard things. And it says that many of his disciples no longer walked with him. And he turns to Peter and the other apostles, the other disciples there, and he says, will you also go away? And I love Peter's answer. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. There is no other. There is no plan B. That you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked, perverse nation, among whom you shine as light. in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. We need Holy Spirit stubbornness, so that we may endure and obtain the prize at the end, for the glory of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. In the midst of this world, in the midst of all the trials and persecutions that we can expect, we need to look beyond the current circumstances of that trial, of those struggles, of those hardships, and look beyond that to God's eternal purpose. Because He's got a purpose, saints. In anything that you may be going through today, He's got an eternal purpose. Whether it is to work something in your character through these afflictions, or whether there is some objective in reaching a soul for Christ, or reaffirming someone who's weak in the faith, He's got a purpose. Never doubt that. God does not inflict willingly, but He does so for our benefit. Amen. We need to remember this. Crosses must be borne before crowns may be worn. You know, in the world they have that expression, no guts, no glory. In the church we could say, no cross, no crown. Crosses must be endured. We must die to self. We must die to the sin nature. We must allow Christ's supreme reign in incremental degrees, more and more in our lives, surrendering to the Lord. We can endure in that way. Here's some examples of endurance that we see even in the world. Thomas Edison, inventor. He had this idea of something the world had never seen before, an electric light bulb. And he would run these two electrical leads, and between them he needed to find some filament, some fiber, that electric current could travel across and glow. The problem was to try to find a filament that electricity could flow through without that filament burning up. You know how many filaments he experimented with before he found the right one? Over 300 different filaments. A friend of his said, Thomas, give it up. It's never going to work. Thomas Edison's response, nonsense. I know that there are 300 filaments that won't work. That leaves me free to search elsewhere for the right one. That's endurance. We cannot allow failure. We cannot allow our failure to convince us to quit. Though we may fall 1,000 times. Well, it says, a righteous man may fall 7 times, but the Lord will lift him up. Thank you. We cannot allow overwhelming odds to discourage us. How many remember that movie, Rocky? Remember that movie, Rocky? Sylvester Stallone? In the second movie, after winning the title, the Apollo Creed, he retained the title. But he was bothered, because as he said, you know, I won the title, I kept the title, but I didn't beat him. I didn't really beat Rocky. And he wanted a rematch. And his manager said, no, give it up, he's past history, don't forget about it, we've got a better candidate to go after. And he says, what's your problem, what are you afraid of? He says, honest? He goes, yeah, honest. Okay, here it is. I saw you beat that man, and beat that man like I'd never seen no man beat before. And the man kept coming after you. We don't need that kind of man in our life. I pray that some lieutenant of Satan might say that to Satan about you. Amen. When he wants to come after you. He says, no, leave that one alone. What? I can take him. No. Look, I saw you beat that Christian down, and beat them down, and beat them down until I thought they were going to be destroyed. And he got up and he kept coming after him. Amen. Now, Rocky had his own heart to give him that kind of determination. Thomas Edison had his own vision to keep that determined sense of endurance. But we have the mind of Christ. We have the wisdom of Christ. We don't have our own heart to rely on to empower us. We have the very hearts, the very spirit of Christ. Amen. Amen. I saw at the gym the other day, a senior citizen. He's probably in his mid-60s. And he had this walker. And he was going from station to station during his workout with this walker. I thought, wow, look at that. This old codger. walking around with this little walker thing, and here he is. He's working out. He's exercising. It was a little while later that I saw him again, and I happened to notice in the right leg, from here down, was a prosthetic. Wow. This man's determined. He is insisting on enduring in his workout, his physical exercise. And then it was a little while later, I saw him at another station, and he had this walker, he had this vinyl case, long vinyl case. And looking at this, and he pulled something out, and there's this clear plastic tube. And he takes this tube, and he puts it up over his head. And he takes the little piece, puts it in his nose, and he reached down and turned the oxygen tank. I'm like, are you kidding me? Wow. That's endurance. You just can't keep this man down. It doesn't matter how debilitated he might get, he's going to be in that gym, he's working out. That's the kind of endurance. I saw that. Oh, Lord, that's a perfect example of endurance. I'm going to use that someday. Thank you, Lord. What does the Scripture teach us about what's necessary to endure? There's a lot of words associated in Scripture with the word endure and endurance. There is abiding. There is continuing. There is waiting and not fainting. There is hoping and trusting. And there is patience and many more besides. But for today, we're going to focus on these. First of all, turn in John chapter 15. We're going to look at abiding. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can you except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me, you can do what? Nothing. Nothing. Let's give up any hope in our own selves that we can, on our own determination, on our own sense of endurance, walk this Christian walk. We can't. We can do nothing. So that's the word right there. Except we abide in him. To abide means to dwell. It means to linger. We would say today to hang out. And that's what branches do with a vine, right? They hang out. That's what they do. It's to make one comfortable in one's surroundings. To make oneself at home. This we are to do in the vine, the Lord Jesus Christ. And just as the branch draws all that it needs from the vine, so too we are to endure and must draw all of our strength, all of our determination, all of our wisdom, all of our guidance, everything from the Lord and none from ourselves. We are to remain firmly rooted and planted in him. Remember what it says in Psalm 1, it says, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. He abides in the law of the Lord. He abides in the word of God. And in his law does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted, boom, planted, solid, right there, by the rivers of water, that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Where? Where? Today, now, are you planted? That's the question. By the rivers of eternal life, or in the desert of this barren world? In a world of deceitful, sinful, empty mirages, amidst the barren, bleak deserts of parched souls, there is an oasis. O-A-S-I-S, oasis. Only the Almighty Savior, Emmanuel, satisfies. Only Jesus, the living water, satisfies the soul. And if we're planted there, rooted and grounded in the vine, in the love of Christ, what do you think? Will one who is filled with all the fullness of God be able to endure? The one who knows the love of Christ that goes far, far beyond what the mind can comprehend, what the heart can contain, but we know the love of Christ by his Spirit. Will that person endure? That person who's planted by the rivers of living water will have the deepest of roots, the greatest resiliency against storms, and the most abundant of ripe fruit. Stay planted there And in Ephesians, as I kind of inferred to, in chapter 3, verse 17 and 18, says that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, listen, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. That's a person who will endure. And you consider the parable of the sower. There's a couple different gospels you can turn to for that. But I looked at Luke chapter 8, verses 5 and 15. And there are four different conditions of ground there. There is the stony places, the thorny places, the fowls of the air. And then there is the good ground. But in each of these cases, we need to examine our hearts. We cannot allow the agents of Satan to steal the time we have in the Word of God from us. We can't be so busy. But the enemy will get you busy. He'll get you even busy, even in ministry, just to keep you away from the Word. We cannot allow the agents of Satan to steal the seed of God's Word. We cannot allow any hardness of heart in our lives, any facet of our life where there might be an area of hardness. We might not be hard in this area, but, oh, there's this person that did something to me 20 years ago, and I'm not going to forgive them for that. There's an area of hardness. We can't allow any area of hardness in our hearts. We need to examine ourselves and ask the Lord to examine and search my heart, Lord. See if there be any wicked way. If there's any hardness of heart, Lord, please remove it. We cannot allow any hardness of heart, that stone, those stony places. The thorns and the thistles. This is the allurements, the enticements, the attractiveness of the things of this world. We get so absorbed sometimes in our pursuits for that better job, that nicer car, that bigger house, and those nicer clothes, and pretty soon we find ourselves, it could be all about these things that steal our time away from the Lord. We cannot allow that. But then there's that good ground. That good ground has been tilled and plowed in humility and repentance and is ready to receive the word of the Lord. And there is a place where ripe fruit is grown. There is the place of endurance. Another word, we looked at abiding, now continuing in the word of God as a true disciple. Jesus said in John chapter 8, verses 30 and 32, as he spoke these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed in him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. A liberated saint who holds on to the truth of God's word as one who was free and no longer tangled in sin and burdened with the weights of guilt and worldly baggage, and then can run the race with patience, enduring to the end. Also, regarding the word, the bread of life, Jesus said in John chapter 6, verse 27, labor not for the meat which perishes, and fill in the blank what meat that is, a higher salary job, or this, or a better neighborhood over here, whatever, just fill it in. Labor not for that stuff, but for the meat which endures unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him has God the Father sealed. You want to talk about meat? Here we go. This is the kind of meat that endures. This is what Jesus said. You know, labor for that meat which endures. And let me tell you something. You may not have heard this before, but you are what you eat. You are what you eat. You eat junk food, you're not going to be very healthy. Eat healthy food, you're going to be healthy. You want to endure it? Well, eat the enduring meat, the meat that endures unto eternal life. You eat this stuff, it's going to become part of you. You're going to be part of it. You're going to be so into it. The Word of God, that will help us to endure. Amen? Amen. Right on. So continuing in the Word of God, continuing in the love of God. Apart from being inspired by God's love, what can we do that will be of eternal value? We love God, why? Because he first loved us. Amen. Now, as we receive the love of God, we just can't help but reciprocate. We just can't help but love him back. I mean, look at him. He is lovable beyond any other. And with that kind of heart, then, we can do those things it mentions in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We can give our money to the poor. We can have faith that moves mountains. We can even offer up our bodies as a sacrifice to be burned, martyred. And if we do that with the love of God in our hearts, that does count. That does count for something. And this is the kind of thing that we need to endure. The love of God, to continue in the love of God. Jude talks about keeping yourself in the love of God. Does that mean that if you don't keep yourself there, God doesn't love you anymore? No. It simply means that you're not abiding in the place where you can experience God's love. Keep yourself there. Keep yourself in relationship to the Lord. That's going to help us to endure and overcome any obstacle. Well, in John chapter 15, it says, verse 9 to 10, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. And continue in obedience to the faith, the word of truth, the only sure foundation that will ensure that anything that's built upon that foundation will stand, that will endure. We read about that in Matthew chapter 7. The house that is built upon the rock is the one who hears the word, but then also obeys the word. And that by the Spirit of grace alone. Remember what I said. We need to use God's Holy Spirit. We need to, you know, from him, from the Lord himself, acquire all that we need in order to walk this walk of faith. Amen. And that's the kind of house founded upon that rock that will endure any storm. Colossians chapter 1, verse 23 says, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, those are terms that are used for buildings, for architecture, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which you've heard, and which was preached to every creature under heaven, where I Paul, and made a minister. And in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1 says, let brotherly and sisterly love continue. By such love, encouraging and exhorting by the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the fellowship of the saints, we help our family in Christ to endure. There was an expedition back in the 70s to the South Pole. They had a very narrow window of time in which they could go down and do this exploratory expedition because there were severe storms before that window of time and there were going to be some severe storms after that window of time. So they had very little time to get in there, get the job done, and get out. Well, toward the end of their time, there was a severe storm that came a little early and they were caught in it. But they had a precaution. All members of the expedition had ropes tied around their waists. And the rope extended to the back, to the next guy, and to the next guy. They were all connected by this rope. And they were heading back to base. What they didn't realize in the howling, blinding storm that was so loud, so blinding, they couldn't hardly hear, they couldn't hardly see. What they didn't realize is one of the men had stumbled, and then the rope got caught in a jagged piece of ice and was cut. And they didn't realize what had happened until they got near the base, and then they realized, we can't go back, the storm's getting worse. We have to abide here for the night, early morning, we'll come back outside and look for this lost man. Next morning came, they all bundled up, they headed out, and 30 feet from that base, there was a man, their man, frozen solid. It was a statue, a monument, to someone who gave up just 30 feet before safety. Endurance is necessary. What else? Well, waiting and not fainting. We can associate the whole thing of endurance with waiting and not fainting. Psalm 27, 14 says, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Isaiah 40, verse 29 to 31 says, he gives power to the faint, and to them who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, The young men shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Notice it says that he shall do these. Not that, well, he may be, he might. No, he shall, they that wait upon the Lord. What does that mean, to wait upon the Lord? The word waiting implies the following. It is a focused, undistracted attention that has a 100% expectation in receiving something. That's waiting. Andrew Murray wrote a little book. It's 31 short chapters. It's called Waiting on God. If you haven't read it yet, I would strongly encourage you to check this out. And what's neat about this little book is because it's 31 short chapters, it makes a really nice devotional. You can read one little chapter each day, meditate on this. It's all about waiting upon God. Well, as I said, this focused expectation, this 100% attention, focused here, expecting something. What I think of when I think of this is one of those little leaguers, catchers. You know, he's in the backyard, he's got his catcher's mitt, he's got the softball, and he's taking that ball and he throws it up. And he's focused. He's not looking over at the dog. He's not looking over, oh, look at that cool coyote that the kid's won. No, no. He's focused right there. He throws that ball up, and he's focused, and he catches it. He's expecting that ball to come down. It did 59 times so far. I think it's going to do it again. You know. And as we offer up our prayers to the Lord, we can expect that answered prayer is going to come down. When we need that strength, when we need that grace, when we need all of what we need to endure, and we wait upon the Lord, we can expect that the answer is going to come, and He will give us what it takes to endure. Amen? The word renew, they shall renew their strength. To renew means to exchange. So I come to the Lord, and I'm stumbling and fumbling and failing in my walk, and I say, Lord, I can't do it in my own strength. You know, can I take this weak human strength of mine and give it to you? When you give me your strength, it's an exchange. I'm going to renew my strength. I'm going to give up on my own. I'm going to rely upon God's strength, His Holy Spirit. That's what it means. Galatians chapter 6, again, referring to the Word of God. For he that sows to the flesh shall the flesh reap corruption. But he that sows, when you sow something, that's a farmer's term. When you're sowing seed. That's what you're sowing. This is the seed of God's word right here. He that sows to the Spirit shall the Spirit reap everlasting life. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And they that wait on the Lord, they shall not faint. So we have abiding, we've got continuing, we've got waiting and not fainting. What else? Hoping and trusting. Hoping and trusting are very integral. They're hoping and trusting are synonyms to faith. When you see hope in Scripture, it's not like, well, I hope I win the lottery today. You know? It's not that kind of hope. That's not a confident hope. This kind of hope is a confident assurance that this is going to happen. I have that hope. Jesus is the blessed hope. We're not thinking, well, He might return one day. I don't know. I haven't seen him yet. No, no, no. He's the blessed assurance. He's the blessed hope. We know he's coming back. That kind of hope. That kind of trust. If you look in the Old Testament for the word faith, you know how many references have the word faith in the Old Testament? Two. That's strange. Did you think? Look at the New Testament. All kinds of references to faith. There are only two in the Old Testament. That's because that in the Old Testament, the word that's translated into our English is the word trust. So trust is there. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 through 5. We're almost done. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation produces patience, and patience produces experience, and experience produces this kind of hope, that confident hope. And that hope does not disappoint, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. So in the midst of your trials, saints, when you're going through these trials, these tribulations, ask God for that patience to endure. He will grant that. And as you endure patiently through that trial, God's going to give to you experience that you would otherwise not have. And through that experience, he's going to show himself faithful on your behalf. And you're going to be so encouraged and so strengthened and awestruck at how God is intervening and working through this trial and giving you victory and overcoming. That's going to give you that kind of hope, so that when the next trial comes, you will have that hope, you will have that experience, you will have that patience, and you will endure. Hope in the proven faithfulness of God. As we see him being faithful in the scriptures, as we read the Holy Scriptures, we see it time and time and time again, how God is faithful to the children of Israel, how God is faithful to his church. We see in the lives of our brothers and sisters who are going through these trials and these tribulations, and we witness in their lives how God is causing them to endure. He's answering prayer. He's working through this trial. We get encouraged there. And then also in our own lives, these testimonies in Scripture, in the lives of our fellow saints, and in our own lives, these testimonies are incredible blessings to cause us to continue and encourage us to continue. Hope, this kind of hope. It can be said that hope is the wind that blows in the sails of endurance. Hope is the wind that blows in the sails of endurance. And once again, from the book of James, my brethren, count it all joy, chapter 1, verse 2 to 4. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience, and let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. And we have 2 Thessalonians. I just wrote down the reference. I didn't write down the verse. I have to actually open my Bible and read the word. So that we ourselves glory in you and the churches of God for your patience and faith and all your persecutions and tribulations that you endure. Some last closing thoughts here. The farmer doesn't expect harvest just as soon as he plants the seed. The student doesn't expect a degree after his first class. The aspiring athlete doesn't expect a gold medal after his first workout. The soldier doesn't expect a Purple Heart as soon as he's finished basic training. These all exercise patience with the understanding that this is a process. I have to go through this process in order to obtain that which is promised at the end. And that's us. We're soldiers of Jesus Christ. We have to endure hardness for his sake. I was teaching on 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 through 4, talking about as good soldiers of Jesus Christ endure hardness. And I was sharing this in a men's group. And that night we all went to sleep. And I was on an air mattress. And guess what? And then in the middle of the night, there is pitch black in the room. I can't see a thing. I wake up. And oh my gosh, where is that nozzle? I can't find it. Where is it? And I can't turn on the light. You know? So I'm just laying there, and eventually I get back to sleep. Next morning I get up, and I'm outside in the mountainside, beautiful mountainside, have my devotionals, and oh Lord, that swore was awful. He said, well, you're the one who's teaching about enduring hardness, so here you go. Thank you, Lord. We are to endure afflictions. We are to endure temptations. We are to endure in order to obtain God's promises. We endure by the eyes of faith, fixed upon God, seeing his eternal mission and objectives in our lives. We endure chastening by God, who is our Heavenly Father, who corrects us for our benefit. And just as we read from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, there's a homework assignment. When you get home, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. 2 Peter chapter 1, 4 through 10. Read that, meditate on that, compare that with Romans chapter 5, verse 1 through 5. You can see a parallel there. It's very good. So finally, James 5:11. Behold, we count them happy which endure. You have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. At the end of his trials, Job said, I have heard of you by the hearing of my ears, but now my eye sees you. Through all the suffering he went through, God blessed him with a deeper and greater understanding and love for the Lord. May the Lord do that for us as well, as we, by the power of God's Spirit of grace, endure for his glory, for his name's sake. Let's pray.